Our next speaker will be Michael Böttinger from eGERM about distributed tracing.
Thank you very much, Dan. Thank you everybody for coming and welcome to my talk about distributed tracing and understanding latency. Quick word about myself, as Dan already said, my name is Michael Böttinger. I started working here at eGERM about 8 years ago, which was when the company was founded. So when I started here, there were actually like 4 people, including me, which was kind of exciting times. And as you can imagine, my role here at eGERM changed quite often ever since then. And my most recent role is site reliability engineer, together with Nora and Dan in the front here. And the team was formed not too long ago, so we're just starting out and we're still learning. And let's jump into the talk. So I wanted to do a quick poll. Who here has a rough idea what distributed tracing is? Okay, that's definitely the majority. Who here is already using distributed tracing in production? Definitely a lot fewer people. Okay, so that's good because then I can actually show you something today. So why do we actually need tracing? And in my opinion, there are 3 topics or 3 questions that we can answer with distributed tracing. The first one, and the most obvious one, is to understand where latency comes from. We heard it also in the previous talk, latency is a very big topic, very interesting. And if you have one service, it might be straightforward to answer, but as soon as you have multiple services that cooperate, it gets more and more tricky. Another point is to understand the service dependencies. Now you might say that you know all your service dependencies, but often it's the case that new service dependencies are introduced and are not documented, or that service dependencies just disappear when the documentation is not updated. And the last point is finding redundant calls. What it means is that if you have 2 services and one service does the same call to another service twice, for instance, which is obviously a waste of resources and often very hard to find in code, but easier to find in the tracing. Now, why are those questions hard to answer? You've probably all seen those charts from various companies showing extremely complex architectures with 500 microservices. Here at eGERM, it's not quite as complex. I made this chart here a couple of months ago, so it's not 100% up to date. It's also not important. It's just to give a very rough idea what we're dealing with here. And back then we had about 30 services and about 50 interaction points between the services. Might wonder why is it not more than 50? To be honest, we have a legacy application which we call our monolith, and it's quite easy to spot in this chart here because it's where most of the errors end up here in the middle. And we're currently working actively on decomposing this this legacy software, and so the number of microservices will definitely increase, and the interaction points will also increase with it. So what is actually distributed tracing? This image here is taken from the DAPA paper, which basically contains all the theoretical background about tracing. It's linked here in the bottom, but it will also be linked at the end of the presentation. And what you can see here is, what you can see here is multiple services, A, B, C, D, and E. And we have a user up here, which could be a browser or a mobile application. And this is where the request originates from the user. And it first reaches the front-end A. And then front-end A does 2 requests, one to back-end B, one to back-end C. And then C, in turn, does 2 requests again, one to D and one to E. And then the responses bubble up again, and finally the front end can answer to the user request. And the user is happy, hopefully. Now, from a tracing point of view, this looks something like this. What you see here is one so-called trace. And in this chart, you see to the right the time axis. And the y-axis doesn't really matter. It just gives you an idea how the calls are structured. And one of these boxes here represents one request within one service. So this top box here represents the request in the front-end service A, and the length of this box represents the amount of time or the latency that is spent in this service. And then you can see that the service does its two calls to B and C, one of them here, the other one here. And you can see how much time is spent in those individual services. And you can also clearly see that the calls happen sequentially, while in backend C, you can see that the calls to its backends happen actually in concurrently. So there's already quite some optimization done here. So if you want to save time in this situation, what you could potentially do is try to parallelize this and this call. A bit about the terminology. So a trace is represents one user interaction or one request from the user's perspective. A trace is a tree of spans, and a span represents one unit of work. This can either be one request within one service, but you can also have multiple spans within one service. For instance, if you have one expensive computational operation within your service, you might want to have a child span within your service to indicate this in your trace where the time is actually spent. Or if you have a database lookup, for instance, something like that. A span consists of a human readable name, obviously, so that we can understand where what it actually is. It has a start and an end timestamp so that we know where it fits here in this chart and how long the unit of work took. It has a parent span ID so that we can form this tree structure, which is optional, because of course the root span does not have a parent. And typically you also have application specific annotations. We heard it in the talk before, canaring is a very interesting topic. So one annotation that you might want to add to your span is the revision of the service where it came from. So if you find traces that, and then in service B, we can take this information and we don't have to do a sampling decision here, although the code is usually in place. Why don't we have to do a sampling decision? Because if you imagine in the first service, you do a sampling, let's say you do you collect 1% of the requests, and now if the second service also would do sampling, that would mean that you only have 0.01% of requests which actually have a complete trace through the system. Well, it doesn't make sense. We want to have a complete picture. So we do the decision once in the first service that is hit by the user, and then in the next service we don't do it. But the code is typically still there, because if some other service calls a service which does not have tracing enabled yet, then we need to do the sampling decision there. Everything else is the same. We also collect the spans and we send them off in batches to the tracing collector. And there all this information is assembled and this tree structure is created. And then everything is stored in some database and made available to us engineers. A bit of an historic overview. In 2010, nobody knew about tracing except some guys at Google. And they had it in production for several years apparently already then, and they found it very, very useful. So they decided to write a paper about it, which is called the DAPA paper because DAPR is the name of the internal tracing system at Google. Then first nothing happened, and apparently in 2012 some engineers at Twitter at a hackathon started working at OpenZipkin, which was then the or became the de facto tracing solution outside of Google. For some reason it took them 4 years to reach version 1.0, which is kind of interesting, I have no idea why. And then things gained a lot of traction. In 2017, Google open sourced their internal metrics and instrumentation library, which is called Internal Sensors. The open source version is simply called Open Sensors. And also in 2017, Uber open sourced their own tracing system, which is called Jagger. Jagger is written in Go, as almost everything else at Uber as far as I know. Zipkin is Java, and they probably just didn't like Java and wanted to have a Go version of it. So what does it look like at Ichim? At Ichim we run almost everything on the Google Cloud platform, and the Google Cloud platform comes with Stackdriver, which is a monitoring solution, and it has also a tracing solution built in. So since we don't want to run our own services where we don't have to, this was the obvious choice. Otherwise, we would have probably just picked Jagger or OpenZipkin or whatever. But as long as we don't find a very, very good reason to do that, we're just going to stick with Stackdriver where we get everything out of the box. Now, Google used to have a Stackdriver specific tracing library. But thankfully, they released Open Sensors, which is now independent of the tracing collector implementation. So by using this library, you can actually technically not only send your traces to Stackdriver, but also to Jagger or something else. Since they also deprecated this Stackdriver-specific tracing library, this was pretty much an easy choice to pick Open Sensors here. Open Sensors is not only for tracing, it's a universal instrumentation library. It supports tracing and metrics, and there's some discussion to also add logging support to it. Why all of those things? Because they all belong together. It's all about observability. What are my applications doing right now? Why are things behaving weirdly? All of those things, logging, metrics, tracing, all of that adds up and should be at the same place. Open Sensors is designed to have minimal overhead. It encourages you to add metrics literally everywhere. Open Sensors distinguishes between adding a metric and subscribing to a metric. So you can add metrics literally at almost zero cost. And as long as you don't subscribe to that metric, you don't have to worry about it. And you can, as far as I understand, I've never tried it, but you can turn on and off those subscriptions, which they call views, even at runtime. So if you have something behaving weirdly, then you could turn on some of the metrics that you added earlier during runtime. Now, we here at Ichim, or at least in the SRE team, we are Go enthusiasts, and this is why all my example code is in Go. I hope you can read it. I also have a Java example, but it wouldn't fit on the slide. So what we see here is part one of three of how to add tracing to a Go service. What you see here is how the Stackdriver exporter is created, and it basically only needs one option, which is the Google Cloud Platform project ID where you want your traces to end up at. And this other option, metric prefix, is a little bit weird because you have to set it to that value, otherwise it doesn't work. It looks a little bit like a bug to me. And then down here, you register the exporter for exporting traces and for exporting metrics, which is the line 16. But we're focusing on tracing here, so I'm not going into more details at this point. The second step is what I mentioned. You need to have a sampling decision, which is called default sampler here. And the way you do this is you simply call trace.applyConfig and give it a config and only specify the sampler. There are multiple samplers available in OpenCensus, but in almost all cases at the moment you're going to pick the probability sampler and you just give it some sort of probability between 0 and 1. I recommend for testing purposes to set this to 1, because if you have an application without any load, you probably want to trace every request that comes in. But always remember in production to set it to something way lower than that. Otherwise, you're going to run into problems. In the best case, you're going to exceed your quota, and it will simply stop collecting traces. In the worst case, you're going to generate a lot of cost with your tracing provider, or you might simply DOS it or whatever, depending on what system you're using. Right, so the last step you need to do is adding the actual instrumentation. I have two versions here, one for a plain HTTP service and one for a gRPC service. It's all for both versions, it's just one line. For the HTTP service, what you basically do is around the handler you already have, you wrap this OpenCensus HTTP handler and you give it this propagation format, which is this HTTP header I showed you earlier. This is just the Google-specific format in this case. You see it from the Stackdriver package. And there are other implementations for that compatible with OpenZipkin, for instance. But for us, this is what we want to pick, because then we get a lot of stuff for free from the Google infrastructure. For the gRPC version, it looks even easier, because here we can simply supply a stats handler and give it this OpenCensus server handler and it's done. You can find the entire example here. The link is also again in the end of the presentation, and I'm going to show you the entire code in a moment. But first, what does the client look like? Again, here for HTTP and gRPC, it's quite similar. For the client, you just give it a special transport, which is from the OpenCensus package. And for gRPC, you again register a stats handler and give it the client handler from the OpenCensus package. And now it's time for a demo. And before I actually execute the demo, I'm going to show you the entire code again, so you see that I'm not performing some kind of magic trick here. So this is the server implementation. The step 1 and 2 are extracted into this function here, because it's the same for all of the demos. You can click here. And it's basically what I showed you. It's just allows you to, that's the Google project ID, show an environment variable, and everything else is the same. So here the exporter is created, it sets the project, it sets this weird metrics prefix that you need somehow, registers the exporter, and here sets the sampling probability, which you can feed in here. In the server, yeah. So in Go HTTP service, you have this server mux, which is basically just a router kind of thing. So you tell it that every path that looks like this is handled by this function. And what this does is that it sleeps for a random period of time to simulate some latency. Otherwise, the boxes would have zero length. It would be kind of boring. And then we simply answer hello from Go HTTP to the client. And now normally without OpenCensus, we would provide this muxer directly here in when we start our HTTP server. And what OpenCensus does is we just pass it basically in between and so that it can get all its instrumentation done for every request. Yeah, and we start the server, and that's everything we need. And then for the client, it also looks just like I showed you in the slides. We give it a special transport here, and we then use this client that we created and do a GET request, assuming that the server runs on localhost port 8080. This is a string you saw in the server mux, and we get a response back, and then with something Go specific, we just call IO copy, which reads everything the server sends in its body and just writes it to standard out. So we just print it on the console. No, not much magic here. And we run this in an infinite loop and do a request every second. Now let's run this. Oh, wait, before I run it, I can show you this tracing interface here. So this is what the StackDriver tracing interface looks like. You can see that it says there are no matching traces, which is expected at the moment. And now if we run the server, so I'm setting the environment variable here with the Google Cloud Platform project where I want to send my traces to. And I need to set one more environment variable which contains the authentication information for the Google Cloud Platform so that I can actually write traces to it. It's just a JSON file. This is the standard environment variable from the Google libraries. That's why it didn't show up in anywhere in my code. And yeah, let's start the server. It's running, it's not printing anything. And for the client, it's exactly the same call. And we run it, and it happily does its HTTP requests, and we get the expected response back. And now if we open up our tracing API again and click on auto reload, can you see that? A little bit small, I guess. But what we can see here now is all the traces that are coming in, and we can click on one of them, and you can see two boxes as expected. The first one is, it's not really scaling well. the first one is from the client. It contains the string send and the path that it requested. And the other one is from the server, and it contains the string receive and the path that it received. And you can see the duration here. And since there's nothing actually happening in the client, the boxes are exactly the same length. And in this example, it's really boring. But you should get the idea. And over here you see also some of the annotations that have been sent with it. This is the stuff you get for free out of OpenCensus. You get the HTTP method, the path, the HTTP status code, status message, and also the host where it was sent to, and some information about the OpenCensus library that was used. And you can also see that the data is, or the latency is distributed between 0 and 1,000 milliseconds quite evenly, just as expected. Right, so that's it, and thank you very much. You can find the code of the demo that I just showed you here on this link. There are code versions for HTTP and gRPC, and there's also a gRPC version for Java in there. Here is the Dapper paper, which contains all the details and the theoretical background. And here's one very interesting video, which gives you a very brief summary about observability in general. If you want to reach out to me, here's my email address. I was asked to add my Twitter handle, although I almost never use it, and my LinkedIn page, and you can find the slides with this URL down here. if you're interested. And yeah, thank you again, and I'm open for questions.